All right, guys, thanks for your patience. Let's get straight into it. We've got a lot of things to cover today. The purpose of today's presentation is to go through the details you need to know about when doing site inspections for your structural engineers. Now, there are some complexities to it, and I want to remind you that this presentation is for people with all types of experience, people that have never been on site before, and a lot of people here that have been on site before. Just be a refresher for you guys, but it's obviously always good information to get on board either way. We'll be going through a couple of screens. So I haven't shared just the presentation, but we'll get straight into it. So an overview of today's presentation. We're going to be going a bit about what Gamcorp does again for people that's the first time today. The structural components, the steel timber components of what a structure is made out of, and then the roof sheet types, but in a different, slightly different view than we've seen in the last couple of times. And lastly, a few project examples, positive and negative examples of when people have sent us through the information. I will like to remind everyone to write your questions in the QA tab at the bottom. I've got Martin here on the background, who's the director of Gamcorp, there to answer your questions. But if there's something he feels that is good to share with everyone, at the end of the presentation, we'll go through them one by one as well. So about Gamcorp, again, we're a structural engineering firm that has been predominantly servicing the commercial solar space for the past close to a decade. We're not only the certification of products coming into Australia, but also for site-specific roof assessments. We've been fortunate enough to be a part of some of the biggest shopping centres in Victoria and some of the biggest projects in Australia. And we do service a couple of other industries related to steel fabrication and playgrounds and bridges and other stuff like that. But our predominant focus, I'd say, about 90% of our business is in the commercial solar space. And in the last couple of years, we've also been doing some physical testing on site for understanding how clamps work, which we'll kind of go through in more detail on Friday's presentations about the secrets of roof sheet clamps. We'll go through a bit of it about it today as well. So getting straight into it, again, for people that haven't had a chance to review this, our assessment process is breaking down into predominantly three components when we're doing a site-specific assessment. The first component is about 50% of it is on the structure itself. And this, in regards to inspections, would be effectively the steel purlins and rafters and the timber, you know, rafters and battens and their capacity and deflection. Another huge weight is the fixing assessment, and that's really just the very small connection between your array frame and the roof. We'll go into what, like, this is predominantly for roof sheets and understanding how roof sheets work, and we'll go into why we need that information so accurately as well. And lastly, not really relevant to today's presentation, but the array frame itself, and we'll do a check on the array frame for its suitability for the site. So let's start off with structural components. So structural components are the components that a building are put together to hold the loads from top to bottom. So effectively how the loads work, at the very top of this purlin, you'd have a roof sheet. That roof sheet's direct supports are the purlin structure. Underneath that is the major support, which is the rafter. The rafter transfers the loads down to the columns. The columns transfer the loads down to the foundation. So again, everything goes back to the foundation. What we've understood at Gamcorp is that when you're putting solar panels on this upper structure, there's not real relevance to checking how the foundation reacts. If you're going to have critical failure, it's going to be closer to these upper members here. So whether the purlins have enough capacity in deflection and also the rafters have enough capacity in deflection in both dead load and in live loads, which is the wind loads. So we're going to now steel components and how we measure them, and then timber components and how we measure them in the next coming slides. So firstly, steel. As we saw in the last example, all these images are going to all like to add are on our checklist that we'll go through in more detail after this. So don't be worried in the sense that you always have this information on hand when you're doing site inspections. But this is just to familiarize yourself with the images, and then we're going to have a checklist kind of breaks it down for you. But going straight into it, purlins are the support that supports the roof sheeting directly, and then the rafters support the purlins, which support the roof sheeting. So what we need to know is effectively these components, I should say, and what their spacings are to each other and how long they span for. So in many cases, you would have like a rafter, this line, this vertical line will represent these red lines. And this ridge line at the top here is almost this dotted line to the center here. So we'd say the rafters are spaced, let's say, 8 meters apart, which means the purlins are going from one connection to another about 8 meters. And then the purlins themselves are spaced every, let's say, 2 meters. Now, it doesn't really matter about their size, as we mentioned in the last presentation. If they're bigger purlins, then they can span longer and they don't have to be spaced as close together. If they're smaller purlins, then likely you have to have them closer together and with less spacing as well. So looking at the main types of steel purlins that you'll see, I would say on 95% of buildings in Australia, the first one is a C-section. The way we measure a C-section is by two key measurements. The first one is its depth, which is effectively that dimension there. Once we have its depth, we understand a lot of the times if it's from a standard kind of C-section, we know what these other distances are. So the depth is the most critical factor. The second to that is the thickness. And I would say is as equally as important as the depth. The thickness of a C-section is significantly, it makes a significant difference. Having a C150 that's 1 mil or a C150 that's 1.9 mil, although it's close to double its thickness, the capacity is significantly more than double. So it's very important that we understand the thickness in great detail. The way we measure this thickness is by the use of a digital caliper or a micrometer. Both are tools that you can buy from a warehouse of some sort, like Bunnings or whatever it is. It's very important to have accurate measurements on this. Now moving on to the Z, similar in capacities. If they're the same depth, if you have a C150 and a Z150, they're very similar in capacity. And again, thickness is also a critical part. The small advantages of having Z purlins is that you can have something called lapping, which we go over in the next slide. But the main point is, again, we take the depth of this Z purlin, which is effectively its height, and then also, again, its thickness, which should be measured by a digital caliper or a micrometer. Now, lastly, is top hats. Top hats have been a big burden for us because they're incredibly hard to measure accurately. The fact that they're quite small in depth, they're usually only about 50, 75 mil in height, means that usually the roof sheet and the mesh and everything else are very close to this top of the top hat, which don't allow you to get these dimensions very easily. Now, on top of that, the worst bit about it, and I don't know if you can see it quite clearly, is on the lip of the top hat there, a lot of them have this almost like this squiggly line towards the end. Trying to get a thickness read on that lip is close to impossible. There's been times where we've spent 30 minutes to an hour just in trying to get the thickness of this top hat. And in a hot, heated roof cavity, it can be quite a bad task. The only way I can recommend getting the thickness is by either going to the very end of the I would say, for example, at the very end of the building, like this section here. And if there is an overhang or a loose end of any sort, then you may be able to get it from that point. But getting it from its actual middle span is very difficult. What I would say is that when this does happen, when there are top hats, usually since the top hats are quite weak, the rafters are spanned closer together. And if that is the case, a lot of the times we can refer to a rafter installation. So when you see top hats, there is a certain level of worry that you should have, but understand that it's more important now that we have the information about the whole building, including the rafters, and we'll try and utilize more of the strengths of the rafters than the top hat. The last point I want to bring on this slide is something called bridging. Bridging is a smaller metal piece that's connected between two purlins. So in this case, if it was on this building, you'd find, if it was one row of bridging, you'd find a bar going through this whole section here. If it was two rows of bridgings at one third length, so one here and at the second third length here, you'd find two bars going through this whole area. Now, they don't go through all the way, it just connects these two pieces of purlin together. And then again, this one will connect these two together, and this one will connect these two together, and it creates this lateral support for the purlins. And it does actually do a significant difference in the capacity of purlins. So in many cases, when people can't identify bridging, and later on we identify it, it can change the results completely. So it's really important to understand that when bridging looks, it has different types of looks and shapes. There's, there's circular rods, there's these steel bars, these steel beams that almost look like a very small thin aluminium C section. There's a range of them that can also be welded sections as well. But in general, it's important to identify between these rafters, do these purlins have any other lateral support? Is there anything in the middle there trying to help them? And if there is, the most important is to take photos. One thing I would say is more than anything, and I should have started with this really, is that more than anything, when you're doing this for your engineers, you are their eyes. So any information you can get in regards to photos is probably more critical than anything else. So if you're taking a measurement of 150, very simply put your ruler against it, or your tape measure against it, I should say, and take a photo of that. So we can now see with our own eyes, he's from the top to the bottom of the Z purlin, and it's clearly the photos. Now going on. lapping. So this is what I wanted to talk about. There's a part of our checklist that talks about the continuity of a purlin and the continuity of purlin, how a purlin continues over or after. So actually, I want to go back 1 second. I just want to highlight, it's at this connection point that we're talking about here. It's when the rafter meets the purlin, right? And that connection point can be done in a few different ways. The predominant ways are these three. So the one is single span, one is lapped, and one is continuous. So we're going to go through what they are now. So a single span is the worst of all in regards to capacity. Effectively, what it means is that when a purlin gets to a rafter, it stops at that point. It's connected with these two bolts. And then a separate piece of purlin starts and continues on. Now, this is very common in C-sections because you can't lap these two together. You can't slide one into the other where you can with Z that we'll look at over here. But in general, when you see a C-purlin, and any purlin really, it's very important that you look at this connection between the rafter and the purlin and see, hey, is it stopping and starting? If it is stopping and starting, then you'd understand that if it's got a support at this point and then a support at the next rafter, the only support it has is two and on their very ends. Now, if you put a load right in the middle of that purlin, you'd see that that purlin would deflect a lot more than if it was, you know, supported by longer lengths of purlin. And the best way to kind of look at this is if you had a long 30 centimeter ruler and you were to put your finger on top of that 30 centimeter ruler and push down, it would deflect a certain amount. Now, if you made it a 10 centimeter ruler and put the same amount of force, it would deflect less, right? So, and if you put different supports throughout the 30 centimeter ruler, you would have even less deflection because it has more support underneath that ruler that you're trying to push down on. So in this case, the worst case is only supports on either end and there's no other intermediate supports. Now, in the lapped case, is when one purlin, let's look at this purlin here. This purlin goes over, it starts from one rafter, it comes all the way here, it crosses over this rafter, and it laps and goes until about this point here. Now, if you look at this white purlin that's underneath this purlin also is going through, and you can see the dotted line, and it crosses over, and it laps, and it ends here. Now, in this section between these two bolts and these two bolts, the purlin is actually double in thickness. And it actually gives you a lot more force. Now, instead of it just being one point of support here with two bolts, you have a whole massive section that's effectively overlapped. And the lapping length is this length of lap. How much is it actually overlapping? Now, the capacity in this is significantly stronger than a single span. So if they had a building and you couldn't tell us, you know, I don't know if it's lapped or single span, then of course we have to assume that it could be single span. And if it is single span, it could really heavily affect the results of your assessment. But if it is lapped, then obviously we get the additional point if a deflection here, and it could be a lot more positive in this example. Now, the last one is continuous. There's two types of continuous. The first one is the one you see here. And effectively what continuous means is that one purlin starts at this point, and instead of it stopping and starting at this rafter, it continues past this rafter, and it stops and starts at the next one, right? By giving this support at this point here, if you're putting any force down on this section here, it actually puts a negative force here. So as this one's bending down, this one actually bends up. So you get a lot more support from this connection as well as this connection, not just relying on a single span between these two points. So continuous is another very, very strong case, and it's very good if you have continuous, continuity, I should say. But the best example is the combination of lapped and continuous. Where on one part it's lapped, and then it continues over the next rafter, and then in the next part, it's also lapped, or it might be single span, whatever it is. The combination of lapped and continuous is usually your landmark structures, or structures that aren't necessarily built too cheaply, usually have that two conditions, both lapped on when it is connected to another purlin, and then it continues past the purlin, and then lapped again. So again, guys, I really want to make this clear. If you guys are, if for whatever reason, this is still not making sense, and it can take some time to understand, 2 points I want to make. The first one is that this is recorded, so please review it online afterwards. And the second one is that take photos, right? If you take photos of this connection for us, we'll be able to determine whether it's lapped, single span, or continuous, or whatever it is. So I don't want you to think, oh, you know, that guy that said that presentation, I can't remember which one lapped was, I can't remember what this is. It's not a problem. Just take a photo of us and let us know. I was unsure, but based on these photos, I believe it's lapped. And that's fine. And we'll review the photos and say, thanks for your effort. It's actually continuous on that, even better. But again, the most important part is make sure you take them photos and give us the clarity around, you know, what the connection type is, because it does play a significant part in the selection of your code. So that's pretty much steel wrapped up. I'd hope it wasn't too complex, and we'll go through a summary of it afterwards. Now let's get into timber. Timber is a lot easier for two reasons. Firstly, because they're usually rectangular shapes, so it's really nice and easy to measure them. And secondly, because we've all been around timber a lot more than we have these kind of steel structures. So timber beams come in certain shapes. Now, there are older buildings that have different shapes, but in general, they are certain shapes that are provided from a manufacturing point of view. So we are familiar with them. The main sections, again, similar to the steel structure where we said the purlins and the rafters, it's very similar in this case, but it's battens instead of purlins, but more or less the same thing, just a different name for them, and rafters, which are consistent with the steel case. But in this case, the rafters are a truss system. They usually look like a triangular shape. They have an underpurlin, or they may have multiple underpurlins, and there's other supports they have there as well. So it's important to understand that in this case, we only really look at the main considerations of the rafter and the batten, but we do need photos of the overall truss and how it works, because that it can play an effect on the assessment, but very rarely will it play a major effect. But we need to, for example, make sure that there is a significant underpurlin and there is that support, whether it's vertical or on an angle or whatever it is. But going back to it, the two main things we're looking at now are the battens and the rafters. When we're looking at the rafters, again, a lot of times there could be double members or there could be single members. If they're a double member, you write 2/ and then get these depths and purlins, right? The depth is always the face that isn't touching the roof sheet or the rafter, right? Sorry, well, this is the rafter, I shouldn't be saying this, but it's effectively the face that is standing, that isn't touching anything, is always going to be your depth. And the breadth is always the one that's connected to whether it's a batten or a roof sheet or whatever it is. And in the same case for the batten, the depth is always the case with no connection with anything else. And the breadth is the one that's actually supporting the roof sheet on one side and connected to the rafter on the other side. Now, for whatever reason, if you're confused on site, you can't remember what I said, which one was the depth and which one was the breadth. Again, not a problem. You take a measurement of the 70, you take a measurement of the 35, and you take photos of them, right? And we can see, oh, yep, the depth is actually 70, not 35 as this gentleman assumed, right? So it's not a problem. Again, critical that you take the photos and we can see what you've measured as well, and we can make that correction for you. But in general, it's really easy. It's really two dimensions, whether it's breadth or depth, and photos. So when you get a timber case, you should feel a lot more happy about inspecting it. The second point I'll make to that is that timbers also gives us great capacity with screw fixings, if they are screw fixings, because you can penetrate through the depth of the timber, and the deeper you go into the timber, the greater fixing capacity you have to it as well. So in general, when I see timber cases, I'm a bit more comfortable thinking that we can get a better result for the client, both because the measurements are accurate. We know the thickness isn't a question now, whether your true caliper was set correctly or whatever it is. We know the dimensions are very easy to take, and we know that the fixing is good. We're going a bit more into now the fixing, and this is what we're talking about. There's two main types of roof sheets. Now, I want to bring this up because this is the 40% weight of our assessment. And a lot of people don't see it as a significant component, but it really is. And I've tried to address that a couple of times now in previous webinars. I really want you guys to take this seriously. And there's a whole presentation on Friday dedicated to this one topic. And the reason is because of all the lack of understanding in the industry about this. So there's two main types of roof sheets. These roof sheets are effectively the only thing that stands between your system and the structure. If the structure is magnificent and it's, you know, great and it's big and it's got all these great things about it, that's fantastic. But if you have a bad roof sheet on top, then your panels will dislodge before your structure deflects, right? Your panels won't be able to stay on top, or the array frame, I should say, won't be able to stay on top or may dislodge before the structure is going to break or anything like that, or deflect or anything like that. So a lot of times this can be the most critical part of the whole assessment. We've gone through this a couple of times, but I will go through it in a bit more detail now. Roof sheet types are two. One is corrugated trim deck kind of look, which is a screwed roof sheet. So you get a roof sheet and you screw them down at different points. That actually looks like a big, either way. The other one is a concealed type of roof sheet where they have internal clips that are screwed to the structure, and then your roof sheet sits on top. Now there's a range of them, clip lock, metlock, long line. There's a range of them. We'll go through the different capacities and why they are different in capacity. But understanding, if you ever get a screwed sheet, it's very simple. You say to yourself, it screws. The capacity of the roof sheet is irrelevant. It's the capacity of the screws that are relevant. And therefore, we just need to know that it's a screwed roof sheet. But if it's a concealed roof sheet, then we need to know a lot more details about the concealed roof sheet. And we'll go on to why now. We've gone through this before, so I am repeating myself here, but I really want to address that it's a very important point. Different types of roof sheets have different capacities, right? The capacity of these roof sheets aren't determined by the thickness of the sheet, right? It's a 0.48 millimeter thick sheet, so it's not really thick at all. They have real no capacity in the sheet itself. It's all in this clip that determines whether this roof sheet will stay or fly off the roof effectively. And how this works is that there's a little clip, similar to the last slide, I'll actually put it here. There's a clip here that is screwed down to the timber rafter in this case, and then this roof sheet is pressed down and locked on top, right? In this case, we have two examples, one both made by the same manufacturer Fielders. One is a cheaper product they have, and one is a more expensive product that they have. The difference in capacity is significant, almost, you know, double, if not more, in regards to its uplift capacity. And why that is because these internal clips really have no real extra measure of security to ensure that this rib will sit onto that clip correctly. What it does, all it has is that little bit of friction between metal and metal there, which is quite low in capacity. So the point is that if there was a high gust wind and your clamps are on top of this, and your panels now become a blanket that can pick up the roof sheet, because before there was no gap between it, but now there is, this roof sheet can very easily slip off that clip and you can create, you know, your panels to dislodge. Now in this case, the Fielders case, the heat clip case, I should say, you can see that the panels, the clip is not only screwed down to the structure similar to this, but they're certainly, they're overlapped and it laps inside the cavity of the rib as well. And it has two significant hooks, both from inside wrapping and out internally, that really hold down this roof sheet. The capacity of this one is, you know, maybe double or triple this Fielder 700. Now the problem is when we go on site and we see that there's a 700 roof sheet, and it could be a range of manufacturers, whether it's Lizard or Fielders or whoever it is, they all have different capacities. And if we don't know which one that is, then a lot of the times we have to assume worst case, which is the Fielders. Because if we assume the better case and we allowed less fixings or whatever it is, when the gust of wind happens, it would create this dislodgement. So we don't want to do that. So we have to assume worst case. We'll go into a bit more of what it looks like on the checklist. We've given you a range of images to look at to be able to identify them. But like everything else that I've mentioned, I'm mentioning it on every single slide. If you can't figure it out, and if you're unsure, take photos, right? Take photos of the width of the roof sheet, one of the most important factors for us to identify it. And then secondly, the most important, if you can, and if you have the capacity to, lift up one of these concealed roof sheets and take a photo of this clip. Now, if it's just not Fielders, it could increase your capacity significantly, right? If we can say, look, we don't know what that is, but we know it's got a bit more strength than this little thing, then it can increase it. And the last point I want to make is that if it is a big project and you need to be 100% sure, and we've assumed Fielders and the results are weak and whatever it is, we can also do roof sheet testing, which is a service that I mentioned to at the very start, where we actually physically go out to your site with testing equipment. It's almost like a tripod. We set the tripod up around a particular sheet. We hook a clamp up. We have a measuring tool that when we pull up the clamp and create a force of uplift onto it, we can test the exact capacity of that roof sheet for that specific site. So very, very commonly used for quite big projects. But obviously, in my personal opinion, it should be used for every project, but obviously that's not realistic. Site inspection checklist. Now, everything we've talked about is on one checklist. Now, this is the old abbreviated one, but this is just a bit of an understanding of how it's kind of laid out. But we're going to go through actually the long checklist now. There is a link on when you get this presentation shared to you, there is a link on it that you can access as well. So going into it, this is what it looks like. The first page, I would really encourage you to read the whole thing at least once or twice on the first couple of times you're doing the inspection, just to refresh your mind on what it is that we actually require and how to get that information and what tools you need to do that. So first, it's very important to read this. Getting straight into it, there's some building dimensions and building factors that are very important to us. So firstly, you know, the average building height. However, the height really makes a difference on the wind pressures. So the average building height is a significant factor you need to give to us. The average slope of the roof. Depending on the slope of the roof, the wind pressure changes. So getting a slope of the roof, you can do it with a simple compass. You can do it on an app on your phone. It's really not difficult to get. That's another important factor. And the other very important factors are the purlin spacing, the rafter spacing, and the rafter span. These three critical factors here. Now, parapet heights, they can help, but they're not a significant help to us. but they can help. So adding any information you can about that, obviously be making sure that you're safe when you're going towards the edges. We don't mind if there's an estimate. If you don't want to go towards the edge, and you shouldn't if it's not safe, please just give us an estimate of, you know, a conservative estimate, half a meter, 1 meter, whatever it is. And it will help with the assessment, but not a significant amount. It's very important to know what kind of array frame and stuff you're using as well, whether you're using a clamp or screwing, and if there is a clamp, what clamp are you looking at using and stuff like that. Panel size makes a big difference as well on the assessment. But a lot of times you guys will just be inspecting for the sake of inspecting, and the solar company will be taking care of that. If that is the case, then you can leave this section blank, and the solar guys that you're inspecting for will give us this information. Now, going into what we're talking about, steel. So this page is dedicated, the first, I would say, 80% of the page is dedicated to steel structures. Here you have your Z sections, your C sections, your top hat, and your Strammer top hat and your Lysa top hat. Difference is that the Lysa is slightly taller, and the shape slightly differs. But either way, the point is that we know the shapes and the thicknesses it should be. Just to help you get to that, and for you to stop having to write down and guess, we just want you to tick, 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 tick. And again, tick on its continuity to give us an idea of what the capacity of that is. So in this case, if we're looking at the last example, you had a Z150, it's 1.9 millimeters thick. There is, no lateral support, or maybe one bar of lateral support between the rafters, so you tick that. And then you look at the continuity, which is that connection between the rafter and purlin, and say, hey, does it stop and start like a single span? Maybe not. Does it lap over the top? Yeah, it does. Sweet. How many spans does it lap over for? How many times does that happen? Every span? Fantastic. Every span. Is it continuous at all? Does it go straight past the rafter and continue over to the next rafter? Tick. It does for that one time, or for two spans, it goes over the whole thing. Great. Again, not a big pressure. If you can't remember this, take photos, make it very clear for us, and we can do that for you. Same thing happens. One thing I'll say, top hats, depth is obviously an important factor. You can see how small they can be sometimes, 22 millimeters, and how thin they can be sometimes. They're an absolute pain to measure. And it can be quite difficult. So, and also how many screws they use, to fix this top hat down to the structure, does do a difference in its capacity as well. And lastly, same kind of thing. Is it single span? Is it lapped? Is it continuous? It also applies to top hats, because they simply just put them on top of each other and they kind of overlap. And if it's, if it's a good day and it's timber, then really easy, breadth and depth, get the measurements. One thing, if you're not familiar with timber, you don't know if it's a hardwood or softwood, just leave it blank. It's not a problem. Just take photos of us and we will do our best to identify that for you. And then things do apply here as well, whether it's single span, whether it stops and starts on the rafter, or it continues past. Majority of the time for timber trusses, they're spaced somewhat closer than you can buy lengths in timber, which is like 6 meters or 7 meters. And if that is the case, then they're likely to be continuous. But again, take photos and we can do that. If it's a non-standard section, which I very, very highly doubt, then simply tick that non-standard section, and there's a space here we can draw the different section that it is. Now, going into rafter, there's really predominantly three that are used, but these are the biggest two, and the third one is, this is an I-beam. The third one is if you take these two flanges away, and it becomes a big C-beam. But either way, if it's a steel beam, I want you to tick that, and I want you to say, the depth of that, which is the height, is so on and so forth. The thickness of that flange is so on and so forth. The web thickness is similar to top hat. It's almost impossible to measure. So a lot of times I expect you to leave that blank. If you're at the end of the building, you can measure that, but a lot of times it can be quite difficult. So I don't expect that too many times. But it is important to understand the flange thickness and the flange width. So flange thickness, I should say, sorry, was that element there, and the flange width was this base element here. Again, if it's a good day and you've got timber, fantastic. Tick that. Depth, breadth, and timber type. If you can't identify it, give us a photo. Now, roof sheets. Big one. We just touched on that. These are the types of roof sheets that we have an understanding of and that we can see are most common in Australia. Now, we don't have the exact capacity for all of these, but we have seen these a lot, so we have added it in these. And we do have the capacity of a lot of these. So the best thing to do is to, if it's a screw fixing, I just want you to tick that. And I want you to move on. I just want a couple of photos showing the screw lines on the roof, and tick that, and get back off the ladder and get back down and be safe. If it's a concealed roof sheet, then you actually need to put a bit more effort into it. You need to measure the width of the sheet, whether it's 700 or 305 or 406 or 680 or 500. There's a range of different widths. And then we need to understand what it matches. And these are some photos. This is what we showed in the presentation just before. But there's, you know, the long line 305, it's factors. So it's 305 wide sheet, the rib height is 48 millimeters. And then the high strength have these horizontal lines that go through the pan. It's a really easy way to identify high strength. And then there's all these other types. The Kudlok 700 Classic lies that looks exactly like the Fielders, which is a problem for us. And then, yeah, again, there's a bunch here that I want you to, when you're on site, say, hey, there's a few images there. Let me see if I can just take some photos and relate it back to these images to see if you can find it. If you can't, it's not a problem. Give us the photos, give us the measurements. We'll do this and we'll try and relate it to any particular roof sheet that we know. Now, if it's an unknown roof sheet, then sometimes we just have to do roof sheet testing, or you can penetrate through this concealed roof sheet. It's never really a favorable option. And then lastly, photos that we require that aren't from the above, just like overall photos of the roof structure, right? It's pretty common knowledge. Take a photo of the overall roof area, take a photo of these purlin and lap connections. You know, it's really important you take photos of these sections. And this is a great example and photo of a real life lap case where you can see it overlaps at this side of the rafter and then to put the bolts there. So that's a real life example of what we were showing you before. And then the same images that you saw before, here they are now fresh in your mind. You've had a good explanation of what it is. Now you can revert back to these when you're in the checklist, right? And you can say, oh yeah, the rafters, the purlins, that was the bridging thing that he was telling me about. And this is the timber elements that he was telling me about. It's all here, it's very clear. Even the single span lapping continuity, they're all there as well under the purlin continuity definitions. You can refer back to these and they're there for your access. I really encourage you to use this checklist, especially for your first couple of inspections. Make sure you're really familiar with the entire checklist. And then later on, as you get more comfortable, it's really only three pages. It's this, this, and this. And these pages take 15 seconds to complete because it's a couple of ticks. And really, these days, I can do an inspection in about 15 minutes. It really is not a difficult task. I'm not saying it's a rush. You initially took me an hour or whatever it was. But once you understand it, the more familiar you get with it, the more fluent you'll be in the whole process. Let's get back into it now. Measuring tools. So we'll do a summary and some points as well. So the summary is make sure you have the right tools, right? There's really three tools that I really recommend. One is a laser light. That's used for all your spacings and all your span lengths. Very important that you have a laser light. It doesn't have to be this high quality one, but in general, a basic laser light will do the job. The next one is a digital caliper or a micrometer. Both are very handy tools in measuring thicknesses. I don't want to see a measuring tape across the thickness of a Z-purlin. It's not accurate enough. When we're talking the difference between 1.6 millimeters and 1.9 millimeters, it's very hard to be able to accurately read that. Accurately read that on a measuring tape. So please don't do that. Use a digital caliper. And lastly, a measuring tape, and that's for dimensions of timber and other issues like that. It's very important that we make sure we have that for that stuff. Let's go summary. Steel purlins, timber battens. Remember, they're the direct supports of the roof sheet. So the beam that's underneath the roof sheet, that's the timber batten or the steel purlin. Okay, and the thickness is critical. I mentioned a few times. Just summarizing that as well. Rafter beams or trusses, direct supports of the purlin. So underneath these beams are these beams, right? And they're called the rafters. If you have any concerns about it, if there's multiple, if there's three rows, which can happen sometimes, then we probably need to know the third row as well. But generally, 95% of the time, it's only two. I should say even more probably. And roof sheet types and slope, very critical factors. It holds about 40% weight in the assessment. So a lot of people do a great job on the structure, but then they give us no information or very little information about the concealed roof sheet. So it can be a negative effect, obviously. Average building height, another important one, very simple. Get down, shoot your laser from the ground up to the top, and you've got your average building height. It's really not a complex measurement to take. Objects hanging off the structure. Now, this I'm going to go into it a bit more in the next slide, but in general, I want you to be aware that, you know, I understand you're not engineers. You may not be engineers, I should say, and maybe this might be your first time. But if you think something's out of place, you need to let us know, right? If there's a big fan or an AC unit or something that's on the roof, you need to let us know. We need to know that there's additional loads in the structure. If there's heavy walkways, you know, like ceiling tiles that are heavy, or anything like lights that are hanging off, you know, certain roofs or whatever it is, they're all added loads. It doesn't mean that it's not going to work. It just means that the initial design engineer might have accommodated for that, but we just need to know what has been accommodated for. So it's always important to take a moment. I'll go through a bit more in the next slide as well. Now, when you actually go into a site, and let's say this is a project that we've been engaged to do, And it looks like there's a bunch of different roofs in this, right? You've got one big one here, you've got a few small ones here. You have, you know, three similar looking ones here, and then a couple of different ones around the edge. Now, if I was to get this and someone said, you know, Sana, can you do inspections on this? You would understand, I wouldn't have to really explain it much, but you can't do one inspection here and apply it throughout, right? There's going to be, this one looks like it's going to be different to these ones, and this one looks different. So what we would expect is to break it up into these color zones, right? You've got a blue one here, you've got a yellow section here, you've got an orange section here, and a little purple section up here. And we'd probably need a checklist for each one, right? Because the purlin's going to be different, the raft's going to be different here, and the purlin's going to be different, the raft's going to be different here. Now, how we identify that is pretty much two really simple rules. Firstly, look at the distances of the ridge lines, right? So the ridge line is a center line. If this is a big distance here, then it's going to be bigger beams than this small little beam, that ridge line difference there. And here you can see four examples, but you know that's going to be, you know, these three are probably going to be the same, and that one may be a bit different. But if we do an assessment, we'd do it on this one and then apply it, or this one and apply it throughout these little buildings that are likely to be the same. But it still is important for you to pop your head into these and make sure, hey, it hasn't changed from timber to steel or something, and they are more or less the exact same, but we don't need three separate checklists, right? And then going to this one, there are slight differences in the cuts of the buildings here, and you might want to inspect one location and then check that these locations are also similar. But you'd only need one checklist for this. But a lot of times we have inspectors going out there and they give us one checklist, and on that one checklist they've said, like, they've broken into like blue 6.8, orange blah blah blah, purple blah blah blah, and so it just becomes too cluttered and too messy. So it takes a few seconds, write on a separate checklist and make sure it's very clear. Again, you know, this is an example of one that have had you know, heavy features on top and things hanging off it that we were unaware of initially from the inspection, and then we found out about it, and then we before the assessment was completed because someone had mentioned it. But it's important when you're going out there understanding, hey, this particular part of the factory may be a fridge, and there's these fridge ceiling tiles that are hanging off it. Is that a difference for you guys? And I'm sure everyone is capable of understanding if something looks a bit out of the ordinary, to say, hey, that might be something the engineers would be considered, like, would need to know about as a part of their assessment process. So when you're in that position, let us know and you know, take photos of it. And if there's any other information you can ask the clients or your end tenant about, you know, when did this fan go in? Was it initially designed for, or did you add it in later on? Really simple questions that give us a lot of information in regards to our assessments. Another thing about new buildings, and we went through this in the PM presentation, sometimes understanding that the edge has got a higher wind pressure zone than the center, the internal, I should say. Sometimes purlins change, right? Sometimes on the edge, they've got certain size purlins that are quite, you know, quite big to accommodate for the wind pressures. And then as they get to the internal, the purlins get smaller. So if you ever have quite a big open span warehouse, I'd recommend a minimum of two inspection points. One is in the corner and one is in the center, or towards the center, I should say. And it's really important that we take that into account on all inspections that we do, because if you just give us one of them and we do the assessment based on that, it could be negative to your results, and obviously it could be harmful for the building as well. So definitely let us know. Think outside the box with referring to loads. If there's anything you think outside the box, you think, hey, the engineers might want to know, it's not a problem. Just write it down, mention it to us, you know, put it in an email or take a photo of it and let me know. Last thing, and really, really, really important one, is give me a call. Any questions on site, I'll have my number on the last page. Give me a call, say, hey, I've been on that site. I don't know, you know, it looks a bit weird. I'll simply say, you know, jump on a video call or take a photo and send it to me, and we can go through it together while you're on site. Only a few inspectors actually take that on board, and I think it's changed them the way they inspect significantly. And they give me a call when they have certain concerns, and after a couple of times, I never hear from them again, and I see just fantastically filled out checklists because they've gotten used to it now and they understand the process, and they don't need to call me anymore, which is great. But initially, if you need that support, we're always here to help you for our projects. We don't want you going out twice, so going out there once and getting the information once is important for all of us. So for our efficiencies, to make sure the project goes out smoothly, and for your end, to make sure your time isn't wasted going out there more than once. Lastly, guys, this is all mainly, I'm sure you all have your own internal processes, but it's something that we do have to mention from a duty of care point of view. Make sure everything you're doing is safe, right? You're working at heights, and I'm sure you guys have your own safe work method statements and whatever it is. So make sure you take all them into account when you're doing these, all the edge zones, all the ladder use, all the working with heights training, the ELP training that you require, is a must for someone who's just getting onto this for the first time here today. There's a lot of information online that you can review for working with heights. I would first direct you to WorkSafe and all their links in regards to working with heights. But then there is a lot of other training courses you can attend, one-day course you can attend, to really get you more familiar on what the safety practices are around, ensuring that your safety when you're doing these types of inspections. It's very important. I won't make any statements in regards to how you should do it. That is, everyone's got their own internal process, but we have a strict process as well. And of course, I do need to mention as well, take into account all the new COVID-19 procedures as well that are happening if you are on site and keeping a distance and everything as well. Now we'll go through three examples, and we're on the final stretch of this before we get into some questions. Three examples of when people send us stuff and it's missing different bits and pieces or it's not done correctly. One is a good example. This is the old checklist. I've done this because I can't really put three pages on this presentation, but we've moved away from this probably over a year ago now. But if you're a very experienced inspector of ours, you would be very familiar with this sheet because you probably filled this out for the last few years. But either way, pretty straightforward. This guy's put everything we needed, right? He's put the roof slope in there. He's got the average building height. He's got the spacings marked incorrectly. He's let us know that it's, a 150 beam, 1.5 mil thick, one row of bridging and a lap, and it's lapped at 900 millimeters. What more can I ask for, right? He said, yes, it is a concealed roof sheet. He said it's a clip lock 406, which means the whole sheet is 406 millimeters wide. And he's given us information on the rafter, right? And with that, he's accompanied it with, tons of photos that we can see all the measurements he's taken, and that's perfect. Now, if we have that and that information, there's no need to go out twice. And he obviously isn't a solar guy, so he doesn't know what, clamps or this or that he's using. Clamps and flush or tilt or whatever it is. But he's just given us the raw information. He's done that well. Examples of it not doing so well is when someone sends me something like this, right? It's so bad quality. I understand that, going out on site and getting information can be quite hard, but that doesn't help at all when we have to chase you for information that isn't presented to us correctly. So make sure the images you take are of high quality, but not only just the checklist, but also when you're out on site. I don't want to, when some people email me files afterwards, or they send me text messages of, different images, we might not be able to see the details of the quality. What we recommend is using cloud-based online storage applications, whether it's, Google Drive or OneDrive or whatever it is that your company or organization uses. It's really important that you store it at its maximum capacity and quality to make sure that we get everything at good quality so we can see it clearly. It might be a very silly statement to most, but it's something that happens too often, to be honest. And lastly, and this is probably the biggest one, is when we lose trust in the inspection, right? When things don't logically make sense. So this is an example of one where we can see that the inspector has done the right thing by getting up and close to the purlins, and he sent us a lot of photos, right? But the problem is that the information doesn't line up, right? There's no such thing as a 3 millimeter 200 purlin, right? Which makes me then straight away tells me he probably didn't have a caliper on site, right? He probably tried to do it with his measuring tape, and there's no such thing as that. So how can that have been done? Now, it could be custom, and I could be wrong, but I very, very highly doubt that. It's more likely that he just didn't have the right tools on the day. He said to us that there's no bridging, NA. And then on the photos, it clearly states, we can clearly see that I've highlighted here in yellow, that there is bridging. Right, there's one row I can see there. I can't see a second or third, but I know there's at least one. Right, and you can argue that he didn't know what it was and whatever it is, but if you don't know, just tell us you don't know. If by saying that, we find that, we lose faith in the inspection. We lose faith in the capacity or the understanding of the person who's done the inspection. So is that three right? Is that 200 right? Is that 1.2 right? I don't know, because there's things here that just don't make sense. Right, and we have the right to obviously reject an inspection, and we don't want you to go out there more than once. But if it's something like this, we have to, right? It's incomplete information, so we can't really rely on it. Other things that might come up is, for example, rafter spacing, not applicable, which means that he probably didn't have a laser on him. Because if he had a laser on him where he's standing, he'd shoot a laser to that rafter there, turn around and shoot another laser on the other side, and he would have had that rafter span. But if he didn't have a laser, it would be quite hard to do. You can't get your measuring tape through all that clutter. So, rafter spacing, same thing, right? If you had a laser, you should very easily be able to get the rafter spacing. Sorry, the comment I made before was in regards to rafter spacing. Rafter span may be difficult to get, but you can still do it with a laser quite comfortably. Guys, that's it. Thank you so much for your time. And I know it was a bit rushed. We had a bit more to go through on this particular occasion. But I want to say that this is recorded, and I encourage you to potentially watch it again or share it with someone you think that would want to watch it, because it is quite critical to making sure that your assessments are done correctly. And obviously the reason we made such emphasis on this is because it's getting harder and harder for us to actually perform the inspections, especially interstate. So it's important that you guys have the capacity to do this and to reduce your overall costs and create efficiencies around how quickly your projects can get done. Now, my number, the office number, the solar email and my email are on the bottom right there. If you have any questions, by all means, shoot me an email or give me a call if it's something that's on site and it's quite urgent. We can go through that. Let's go through the quick questions that I've put on here. During my last inspection, the rafter width was 600 millimeters. This is from Ahmed, sorry. The rafter width was 600 millimeters from the lower level, and from the upper level, it increased 750. Why is that? How does this affect the results? Yeah, and it can happen. It's very, very rare that it can happen. There's two types of cases where this happens. There's a haunch at the end that's thickened, and then as it gets to the top, it's decreased. The reason, a lot of the times, the reason for that is because the loads, Ahmad, when they're designing this, are different for the different areas of the building. And if that is the case, then they have to accommodate that for that level of thickness. So they increase the thickness where they need it, and then they reduce the thickness. And the reason they do that is to save on steel. And by saving on steel, the builder's happy, the engineer's obviously done a better job, and their client's happy that he's paying less overall as well. So if it happens, it's very rare, but if it does happen, it's because of the loads that it's kind of dealing with. Now, there is 11 more answered questions. I won't go into them in too much more detail. If there is further clarification you need on them questions, by all means, please email me below, copy the question, and we're definitely, like, I think the last presentation I had, maybe 10 or 20 extra questions, and it's fine, can be done at a later point. We'll go through to Rex. Rex, do we need to know how long the screw are for trim deck and diameter? Okay, so Rex, if you're talking about the existing screw that's there, no, you don't need to know, we don't need to know about that. When we define the installation, we define what screw you should be installing with, and you shouldn't be using the same screws that are already on site. And the capacity of that screw is dependent on the screw that we give you and how much it penetrates through the thickness of that steel. So the short answer is no, we don't need to know the information of the screw that's there, because we're not hoping to use that screw again. If you use the exact same screw, you lose a lot of the friction. You want to use a slightly bigger screw to recreate that friction between the screw and the bushing. Hope that's understood there as well. Guys, I think that's all the questions for now. I really want to say again, thank you so much for your time today. This is obviously an ongoing process that we all want to improve on and everything like that. So if there's any additional questions when you're on site or when you're in your office now, you have any additional questions, feel free to email me, give me a direct call. For now, thank you so much for your attendance, and we'll get the recording on our website by tomorrow. Last thing, I'll take this opportunity to say that on Friday, we talk about roof sheet tests, roof sheets in general. We're going to be going through roof sheet testing on site, how it works, why it's done, and also going through some manufacturers and what testing they've done to show us the understanding of how these clips work when they're initially being released into Australia. So without further ado, guys, thank you so much. Take care for the rest of the day and the rest of the week. We'll see you on Friday, hopefully. Cheers, guys.